You're now watching the second interview with Tom Erickson. Tom is an interaction designer and researcher. He's working for IBM in the Watson Lab in New York. Here he's working in the Social Computing Group, and he's been working here since 97. And before that, he worked for Apple for 9 years. So he is an expert on social computing. And today he'll share with us some of his advice on how we can apply this knowledge when we're designing social computing systems. So, Tom, can you give us your three favorite pieces of advice when we're designing social computing systems?
It's always hard to give advice in the abstract, right?
Yeah.
So I guess my first piece of advice is to find similar situations in the face-to-face world and look very closely at them and try to see what social forces are making that system, making that interaction work.
Mm-hmm.
And then you ask yourself, are there ways in which I can either reproduce those or create analogs to them, or if I can't do that, to compensate for them? So for example, one type of thing that you often see and happening in the face-to-face world is people are having an interaction, and people who are not part of it are passing by, notice it, and they get curious and they approach and they hear a little bit more about it and they get drawn in, right? And clearly for a lot of the social computing systems we're designing, we'd like that, right? That's how you make a system sustainable. It sort of brings in new people. And so you might ask, okay, well, what can I do in this system to help draw people in from the outside, right? It might not be, you know, you might not be able to have the analog of citing the system in a place where other people are sort of naturally coming along. That might not make sense in the online world. So you think about, well, what are ways that this can, you know, fragments of the interaction or things it does can attract other people and pull them in. Wikipedia is a good example of that. Now that it's become so popular that if you search for anything on Google, very often, very high in the search results will be the Wikipedia article. And so, you know, that self-reinforces Wikipedia, right? It pulls new people into it.
Okay, so that's one piece.
Ah, yes.
Second one.
Sorry, you wanted three pieces of advice.
Yes, please.
So three pieces. Okay, so the second two pieces of advice will contradict one another. The second piece of advice is try to deeply understand whatever you're designing for yourself. Try to understand the experience. Try to, if you found a real-world counterpart, try to go there and be part of that face-to-face interaction and see which bits of it feel interesting or frightening or provoke your curiosity or put you off or scare you, just whatever. Try to really experience it yourself. I'm a very big believer on drawing on one's own experience. So that's advice, piece of advice number two.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of ways that you can do that, right? One is actually going into the environment and having the experience firsthand. But if you can't do that, it means talking with lots of people who have that experience and trying deeply to understand them. It's sort of, you know, doing ethnography on a one-to-one basis, but trying to get the feel for what it's like to be inside that interaction. Okay, so that's piece of advice number two. Number three is don't rely solely on your own intuition. Instead, I guess what I like to say is, if you know enough to design something, you know too much to understand how ordinary people are going to experience
it,
right? Which directly contradicts what I just said, but I just think people also, maybe advice number four is be comfortable with contradictions. But anyway, you can never, as a designer, you can never really understand how others will experience your system, because as a designer, you know the entire system. You have the picture, you've got the architecture mm-hmm. in your mind, you have the image of it, and somebody new coming into it will only see the little bit that they first encounter.
So what is your advice to how can designers find out what the users experience?
You build the system and you put it out there. Mm. That's by far the best way.
Okay.
So, you know, again, I'm an advocate of getting things out into public as soon as possible.
Mm-hmm. What do you consider the three biggest mistakes when designers are designing social computing systems?
I'm not sure it applies just to social computing system. I think the biggest mistake is being too immersed in your own idea. You know, it's you often see people who design something essentially for themselves and just never even imagine that other people might not like it or would want to use it very differently than they would, or use it for different purposes. A second mistake, which is related to that first one, although I think you can sort of avoid the first one and still fall into the second one, is as designers we all always have an image of how we believe people will use the system, right? So we think people will use this to make friends with strangers, or we think they'll use this set of cues to let you know that people are paying attention when you're speaking. And in fact, sometimes people will do that, but other times they won't. And the mistake I see is that people often project what they imagine the use will be into the language and constructs of the system. So let me see if I can give an example. In the Babel system, so Babel was the multi-channel chat system where you could enter a chat room and have textual conversations with other people. And in addition, it had what we called the social proxy, or the cookie, which was a visualization that had a small circle and dots. And when you logged onto the system, your dot would show up inside the circle. And when you typed a bit, your dot would move into the center. Okay, and so what we imagined is that when you were having an active conversation, that the dots, because people were typing or clicking or scrolling, everything would move into the center and people would feel like they were in a conversation. And that indeed happened. But we also saw some other interesting things. So and so one of the points here is we tried very hard when we gave help about the system, when we instructed the system, to make it clear that when the dot moved in, all it really meant is that somebody was typing on their keyboard or moving their mouse. It was a great temptation to say, when the dot moves in, it means somebody's paying attention to you.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, we saw cases where either people would, somebody would say something and I'm not paying attention, but to be polite, I'd hit my space key, move my dot in, so I was pretending to pay attention, mm-hmm. right?
Which you can also do in real life.
Yes, I mean, so one of my design principles for social computing is that you should always allow people to, the way I baldly put it, is always allow people to lie. But you know, the real point is always allow people to be polite, which sometimes means saying things that you don't believe, mm-hmm. right? At times when we would talk to engineers about Babel and talk about, oh, and the dots move in whenever you type, somebody would say, well, wouldn't it be great if you could put, you know, EEGs on people's heads, and if they were, you know, just tell if they're paying attention and then move the dot in. And my answer is no, that's actually not a good idea, because You want to give people the ability to pretend to pay attention mm-hmm. as a way of exhibiting politeness, even if they're really bored, right? Mm-hmm. That's how we manage our social relationships.
So I'm just nodding now. I'm not listening at all. Not true. Do you have any other kind of big mistakes we should avoid?
I think the only other one is not trying a system out on strangers who don't care about it. Mm-hmm. Developers will very often use a system in the development group. And of course, everybody in the development group really cares about it. Mm-hmm. You really need to get the system into the hands of people who really don't give a damn about you or your system, and they just have some ends that they want to pursue. Might be for fun, might be for business, they're not trying to be helpful to you. Mm-hmm. They don't care about you, and that's the most powerful kind of test you can do. And it's also a hard one, because certainly in the environment I work in the enterprise, if you give it to a bunch of people who don't care about you, it means they're using it for real things, and if the system crashes, they're going to be mad. It's going to screw things up for them. Mm-hmm. And if the system works and then you try to take it away, they're going to be mad too. So, you know, on the one hand, it's a great thing to do. On the other hand, when you do it, you're making a lot of promises, at least implicit promises, about that this is going to be stable enough so you really can do your work, and we're not going to yank it away from you in 6 weeks. Mm-hmm. And that requires a lot of commitment both from you and from your organization. Mm-hmm. So that makes it hard.
Thank you, Tom, for passing on your advice and for sharing some of your guidelines, as well as knowledge, perspectives, and best practices. It's been wonderful. And if you want to know more about social computing, you should have a look at the chapter Tom has written, and you can find it, of course, at interactiondesign.org. Here you can also find other interesting chapters and interesting videos as well. Thanks for watching.